glad to have you with us today. I'm Pastor Kurt Lemko, coming to you on behalf of Christ Lutheran Church in Rochester, Minnesota, with our worship today. We're thinking about several things. Actually, Labor Day weekend is this weekend, so that makes us think about work. And then we move on to work in a Christian sense, and finally, just the attitude of the work of forgiveness, shall we say, to restore people to relationships. So that's the focus of what we'll be doing today. So let's move toward worship, and we begin in the name of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Psalm 32, a paraphrase. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I did not declare my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you and did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Then you forgave the guilt of my sin. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. With that, we move toward our first reading from Romans chapter 13, beginning at the first verse. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. So ends our reading from the 13th chapter of Romans. The Holy Gospel is written in Matthew chapter 18, beginning at the first verse. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? He called a little child to them and placed the child among them. And he said, truly I tell you, unless you change to become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to the person through whom they come. If your hand or your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or crippled than to have two hands or two feet and be thrown into eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go to look for that one that wandered off? And if he finds it, truly I tell you, he is happier about that one sheep than about the 99 that did not wander off. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should perish. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you will have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. So ends the reading of the Holy Gospel. Dear friends in Christ, Labor Day weekend is here. And that used to be the time when we would think of the end of summer and, for most of us, the beginning of school. A whole new way of going about things started with Labor Day. That still is somewhat true today. It's the last three-day weekend for a while. It's a holiday. It's a holiday when we celebrate the working man and the working woman, those who labor, hence the word labor for Labor Day. I just thought it was kind of strange that on a day when we celebrate working workers, we take the day off. I guess maybe that's something which is appropriate, because if you work a lot, you need a day off once in a while. In any case, work is the way that God provides for his people from a Christian point of view. So if we have a job, it's very obvious, we get some payment and we get a way to buy food and clothing and all the necessities of life. But there is a higher calling for the people of God when it comes to work. It's something which is a response to God. We think of it in different terms. And so Labor Day for us has a double meaning, not just the labor of people, but our labor in the kingdom of God. There is that kind of a necessity that's part of working. In fact, in 2 Thessalonians 3:10, Paul says, if any would not work, neither should he eat. That's kind of harsh, huh? But there's some context around that. You see, the people of Thessalonica took the message of Jesus very seriously. And one of the things he said was that he would return. And so some of these folks thought, well, maybe that's going to be tomorrow or the next day. So why worry about anything? Why worry about having a job and getting anything ready to eat for my family, that kind of thing, because he's going to be back so soon. It wouldn't make any sense to waste my time doing that. But Paul says, no, while you're here, you make a contribution to the community and to your family. It's amazing, even in the Christian community, people just kind of drift toward whatever is beneficial to them from their point of view. And I think that's part of the reason why Labor Day is here. Because at some point, those who employed others would take advantage of them. And so they had to get together and form unions so that they could make some demands concerning their wages, their rights, their working hours, their working conditions, that kind of thing. And then when the unions got very powerful, then went the other way, you know, and it's back and forth and back and forth, kind of fighting all the way along. And it got pretty ugly at some points, where there were people fighting, not too unlike, I suppose, what's going on today in our cities, where people are getting violent and burning things down, that kind of thing. Kind of reminds me of the first time I heard about that type of thing. Remember old Rodney King? I think it was in Los Angeles. He was beaten and caused a big ruckus. And he said, can we all just get along? And the answer is, no, we can't. Not as ordinary, selfish people. In fact, even pastors have that problem. I remember a pastor who had some trouble in his home. His children were kind of rebelling, and he didn't like that, and he was complaining to another pastor, and he says, it says in Ephesians 6, children, obey your parents, for this is right. This is from the Lord. Honor your father and your mother. That's the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth. And the other person said, that's interesting, because that's the part the children should read. Doesn't it say, children, obey your parents? They should be reading that. The part that you should be reading is the next part where it says, fathers, do not provoke your children. So even in those circumstances, it seems that people are looking to whatever seems best for them. In our Christian community, we try to think about things from a spiritual point of view. At the end of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. And so the primary purpose, when we sort it all out, is to be doing God's work. That's not really something that comes naturally to us. And we look to Christ for an example. So Christ was the one who did what was necessary. He was the child of the Father who obeyed, and that meant going to the cross. I think there's more to that cross than sometimes we think about. We kind of mention the cross and go on and don't really think about it, but there's one phrase during that period of suffering that really stands out in our thoughts for today, where we think about people being separated and being restored to relationship again. And that's the phrase where Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Actually, in the Bible, that's one of the primary characteristics of hell, being forsaken by God. And so we could say he experienced hell so that we never have to. And then he gives us a new pattern for living. Forgiveness, restoring the brother or sister, coming together again as we were separated by those things, those acts of rebellion against each other. Then you have something like, I think it was Boys Town, Nebraska, where we had this one ad, I always remember it. There was a boy with another little boy on his back. He was carrying him. Apparently he was crippled. And the phrase underneath was, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. That's the attitude that comes from seeing Christ and seeing what he did. And so we celebrate Labor Day from a Christian perspective, recognizing all those who work on a regular basis, and also recognizing that we have also a higher calling as the people of God. Labor Day actually was started in about 1882, and the first Monday in September was the designated day, and it wasn't really a federal holiday until 1894, and by that time 30 states were already celebrating that. There was a man who was pushing that idea. His name is P.J. McGuire, so he's called the father of Labor Day. But in any case, for us, it has a double meaning, recognizing workers and recognizing our work for God. There's a story that illustrates the attitude of forgiveness. My pastor friend, Dave Gunderson, who was serving about 25 miles from me in South Dakota, in Yankton, South Dakota, told this story. He said, every congregation should hear this story once a year. So here it is for 2020, right? Story about Billy and Sally and Gertrude the Goose. Now, Billy and Sally had great parents. They were responsible and they took care of them well, but they were also very practical. Billy wanted a BB gun, and he begged and begged and begged, and they said, we don't think you're quite old enough for a BB gun, because you could do some real damage with that, and you need to be a little bit older, a little more responsible before you get that. It was somewhat the same for Sally. She wanted a baby doll, a doll that would say mama when she sat up, and she had some other little things that were kind of unique, a little bit advanced, more than other dolls. And they begged, but nothing happened. Parents put them off. One good thing that happened to Billy and Sally was that every year they got to go to Grandma's farm for a week. Wow, they had a great time, because Grandma was just always so good to them. So they went to Grandma's farm. They opened the door, and guess what? Grandma handed Billy a BB gun. Oh, he was so happy. And of course, Sally got the baby doll. And so one thing that happened at Grandma's house also was that they took turns helping with dishes at the end of the day. One day, Billy would do it. The next day, Sally would do it. And so this was part of the program, and they said, yeah, we don't like it, but we'll do it because we have so many other good things. Well, Billy was out with his BB gun. He was having such a great time. He threw a stick out in the pond and tried to make the stick move with the BBs that he would use to hit the stick. And he'd take a tin can, put up on the top of a post and rattle that thing with a BB. And he got so that he could hit that about 7 out of 8 times from about 25 feet away. And he was really feeling good about that BB gun. And while he was celebrating a little bit, across the yard came Gertrude the Goose. And he said to himself, oh, I'm just going to shoot right in front of Gertrude and make her jump. That would be funny. And so he pulled up his BB gun and shot, and Gertrude dropped like a rock and didn't move. She was dead. Now what will I do, Billy thought to himself. So he dragged Gertrude behind the barn and covered her up with straw. That night, of course, it was Sally's turn to do dishes. But she said, "You're going to do the dishes tonight." He said, "What do you mean?" He said, "I saw the whole thing with the BB gun and the duck." And he said, "Oh, no, don't tell Grandma." She says, "Do the dishes." He said, "Okay, okay." And so it came time to do the dishes, and Billy helped with the dishes. And then the next night, it was his turn, he did it. The next night after that, Sally talked to him out in the yard and said, "You're gonna do dishes again tonight." And Billy said, "That's not fair, I already took a turn." She said, "Remember the duck." "Okay, okay, I'll do it." And so after about 3 days straight, and the fourth day when he was already committed, he said, "I can't do this anymore. I'm just going to tell Grandma what happened." And so I went to Grandma and said, "Grandma, I shot Gertrude and she died and I didn't mean to and I'm sorry." And Grandma said, "Yes, I know, Billy. I saw the whole thing. I was just waiting for you to tell me so I could forgive you." Oh, what a great relief that was to Billy. But it's also a picture of the heart of God, just waiting for us to confess so that he can forgive us. What is your image of God? Luther thought of God as a stern judge waiting to condemn him for the things that he did wrong. A lot of people think of God as sort of a grandfather figure with a long white beard sitting in a chair, just kind of smiling over everything that people do, right or wrong. But here is a picture of the heart of God waiting to forgive. The most common reference, I think, to God is God as Father, the waiting Father. You probably remember the story of the prodigal son who took his inheritance early and went and spent it all. And every day his father was out looking, "Is he coming back? Is he coming back?" And he did come back. And instead of scolding him and condemning him, the father forgave him and welcomed him back into the family, no questions asked. And so that's the kind of God we have, the kind of God who is waiting to forgive us, waiting to restore the relationship. And that's how we also deal with our fellow Christians. We are waiting for them to come if they've done something wrong so that we can forgive them and restore the relationship. Can't we all just get along? Yes, we can, with the example and help of Christ. Amen. Having heard God's word, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we pray with the assurance that you love us enough to forgive us. You are waiting for us to confess so that you can forgive us and restore the relationship between us. The cross of Jesus reminds us that you love us even when we are not aware of your love. You love us even when we forget that we can call ourselves your children. Help us to see again how much you love and accept us, even when we fail. We are unable to love you as you love us, but help us to grow in love until we fear nothing more than living outside our relationship with you. And as we grow in love for you, let us reflect that love to those around us. Let us do those simple things which prevent the spread of COVID-19 to others, such as wearing masks, washing hands, and avoiding large crowds. Add your protection and healing to the treatment of those who struggle with physical challenges. We especially ask for your healing touch for Dean Erdman as he faces surgery this week. Guide all those who care for him as well, so that they may do their very best work to set the stage for his recovery. Even though we are separated physically, let us be united in our concern for others who are ill or homebound, those who face uncertainty in education, and those who are unsure of their jobs. Keep us together as a family of worship and service. In the name of Jesus, who has called us to follow him and has taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.